Your friends, on average, have more friends than you do. This statement seems impossible, but it's true, and it can be utilized for early detection and prevention of an outbreak. Before we get into the applications of this paradox, let's spend 2 minutes to understand what it means and why it is true. Alice, Bob, Carol, and Dan are a part of a social network. Let's represent them as nodes and draw edges connecting the nodes to indicate friendships. Based on this graph, Alice is friends with Bob, Carol, and Dan. Bob is friends with Alice and Carol. Carol is friends with Alice and Bob. And Dan is friends with Alice. There are 4 individuals, and they have a combined total of 8 friends. So on average, an individual has 8 divided by 4 friends. On average, an individual has 2 friends. Now, let's take this one level deeper. Alice is a friend of 3 individuals, so we'll put her friends list below each of those instances. Bob is a friend of 2 individuals, so we'll put his friends list below each of those instances. Carol is also a friend of 2 individuals, so we'll put her friends list below each of those instances. And Dan is a friend of 1 individual, so we'll put his friends list below that instance. So the 4 individuals have a combined total of 8 friends, who have a combined total of 18 friends. So on average, an individual's friend has 18 divided by 8 friends. On average, an individual's friend has 2.25 friends. On average, an individual has fewer friends than his friends do. And it is that way because the popular individuals are overrepresented in the latter calculation. In other words, popular Alice shows up in each of the other's individual friendship networks and thus can make them all feel relatively deprived, while unpopular Dan shows up only in Alice's friendship network and can only make Alice feel relatively advantaged. It's a form of sampling bias in which people with more friends are more likely to be in an individual's friend group, and this bias may have important applications for studying the dynamical processes on social networks, like detecting an outbreak. There are a lot of factors which affect one's likelihood of contracting a virus. Some examples are age, underlying health conditions, personal hygiene, airflow and ventilation conditions, and position within a social network. Individuals near the center of a social network are fewer steps away from the average individual in the network, so during the course of an outbreak, they are likely to be infected sooner than those at the periphery, all else being equal. Take these data on the progress of flu contagion in a network of 714 students at Harvard in 2009. Red nodes correspond to infected individuals. Yellow nodes correspond to friends of infected individuals, and the node size is proportional to the number of friends infected. It's subtle, but on average, the red nodes are larger and in a greater concentration at the center of the network. But when it comes to large networks, like a city or a country, it would be costly, time-consuming, and intrusive to map out the entire social network in order to identify the centrally located individuals. And this is where the friendship paradox could come in handy. In that Harvard study, they randomly selected a group of students and asked them to name their friends, and then they tracked flu illness patterns in both groups. This plot shows the cumulative incidence of influenza over time for the group of randomly chosen individuals. It follows a typical pattern. Initially, infections increase exponentially as the contagion spreads, and then decreases exponentially as the susceptible population shrinks. This curve shows the incidence pattern for the friend group. Notice that this curve is shifted to the left. What this means is that the progression of the outbreak occurred 2 weeks earlier for the friend group than for the random group. These two curves diverge at a very early stage of the outbreak. And if this were a real-world case instead of a research study, this divergence could have been used to alert health officials of a developing outbreak before it hits the population at large, giving them added lead time to prepare for and respond to the outbreak. And on a side note, given that the friend group is better connected and likely to be infected sooner, an effective immunization strategy might be to vaccinate the friend group first. There's another form of outbreak which relates to the friendship paradox: things that go viral on the internet. and social media websites like Facebook and Twitter offer an ideal platform for studying the friendship paradox. They have huge global user bases, and their connections are fully mapped out. In 2011, researchers studied the entire Facebook social network, and they found that 92.7% of users, on average, have fewer friends than their friends have. This plot shows an individual's friends, average number of friends, versus the individual's number of friends. So for example, if you have 400 friends, then your friends, on average, are expected to have 600 friends. This diagonal line corresponds to you having, on average, the same number of friends as your friends do. And as you can see, until you have nearly 800 friends, your friends, on average, are expected to have more friends than you do. Now let's look at Twitter. Twitter is a microblogging service on which users post short messages, often accompanied by keywords marked by a hash, to help them show up more easily in Twitter searches. Now, unlike relations on Facebook, Twitter relations are directional. When you follow someone, information flows in one direction. You get updates on their tweets, but not vice versa. You are the follower, they are the followee. In 2013, researchers studied a large portion of the global Twitter activity from 2009, and they found that 98% of users were less popular than their followers and their followees. In 2014, other researchers used a different 2009 Twitter dataset to explore hashtags going viral, a form of digital contagion. They compared randomly chosen individuals with a random selection of people they followed to see whether trending Twitter hashtags were used sooner by the followee group. In this study, they analyzed the performance of the 32 most widespread hashtags that appeared in their sample groups, and they found that, on average, members of the followee group used the hashtags before the random group for all but two hashtags, with an average lead time of 7.1 days. Suggesting that by simply monitoring the activity of a followee group, you can detect viral outbreaks of the use of novel hashtags 1 week earlier than if you had monitored a random group. And even though this example is just of a digital outbreak on the internet, knowledge of the online activity of a group known to be central to a network has the potential to provide early insights into real-world outbreaks. For example, if Google observes a spike in searches related to the flu, well, maybe a celebrity got sick. Or maybe someone discovered a universal vaccine for the flu. Or maybe there's a new documentary on the flu. There could be a lot of reasons for the spike, but one of those reasons is that people are Googling the flu because they are sick with the flu. And if Google were able to identify the spikes associated with the latter, it could be useful to know the centrality of those sick people. Are they people on the periphery of a social network? Or are they people who are central to the network and in a position more likely to infect others and initiate an outbreak? We could spend a lot of time going into the feasibility and ethics of generating and accessing such information. But let's leave it at this. Information is power. The friendship paradox is not just an interesting statistical phenomenon. It can have real-world applications, especially in our interconnected world. If you like this video, click that like button. If you like paradoxes, check out my channel and subscribe. And in any case, thanks for watching.